Okay, so yesterday we started to cover the notion of Grothendieck ring in the not necessarily semi-simple case. So we first introduce the notion of Grothendieck group, which can be defined for any abelian category. So recall that this involves a finite Jordan holder sequence and a multiplicity of simple appearing in the quotient of the Jordan holder sequence. So you take this multiplicity and you generate the group, the abelian group generated by the simple object up to isomorphism. And then every object of the category, the class of every object can be written as a sum of multiplicity and in fact, the class of the simple object. Oh yeah, here there is a mistake also. Abelian group generated by simple object. I guess we should write, oh, it's okay, but you should write the class of the simple object, not the simple object itself. Anyway, okay, so that is okay for the direct product, so the addition structure of the Grothendieck ring, the Grothendieck group. Now, what about the multiplication? So for the multiplication, you need the abelian category to be a tensor category, or more generally, a multi-ring category, it's enough. You consider the simple object up to isomorphism. Again, we need to assume the object to have finite length. Okay, but I guess it's, yeah, okay. So you consider, you induce a multiplication between the class of two simple objects as the decomposition as this class, the class of the tensor product of the two simple objects. So as we've seen before, this decompose into, so again I forgot to put the class, this decompose into the multiplicity of that for each simple, and you put the simple also. Okay, so that's defined a multiplication called the fusion rule. Okay. Yeah. So of course, this fusion rule, so these Grothendieck rings do not completely characterize the category, as I already said. One fusion ring can have zero, one, or several non-equivalent categorification. So, yeah. This is defined for simple object, but you can extend that linearly. It's a lemma that it is well, it can be done to any object. So the class of a tensor product is a product of the class. And the proof of that requires to use the exactness of the tensor product. Okay. So what is important is that this multiplication is associative. So this the proof of that reduced to prove that for the simple object, then you just need to use associativity of the tensor product. Okay. So when you start from a multi-ring category, what you get is the Grothendieck ring you get is a Z plus ring. So it's not a fusion ring. is something weaker than a fusion ring. It's called a Z plus ring, where the unit is a class of the trivial object. So this is the defined. So this, by definition, the Grothendieck ring of this multi-ring category. So it's a Z plus ring. It's a corollary. So what is the definition of a Z plus ring? So a Z plus ring. So it's a ring together with a basis such that the product of the element of the basis decompose into element of basis with a non-negative integral coefficient. So this was the definition of Z plus basis. Okay, so Z plus ring. A Z plus basis of a Z plus ring is what I said, and a Z plus basis of a ring is what I said, and a Z plus ring is a ring with a fixed Z plus basis. And the unit should decompose as a positive sum of element of the basis. Okay. So sorry for the confusion. What is important here is that it's a ring with a fixed. It's not that there exists a basis. You fix one basis, which is very important to fix. Okay. And the Z plus ring is called unital if the unit is in this fixed basis. Okay. So as a ring, a Z plus ring is just a free Z module. So of the form Z puissance G power R, where R is the cardinal of the basis, so called the rank. So a notion which will be useful for the Frobenius-Perron theorem, the transitive notion. So a Z plus ring with basis B is called transitive if you take two elements of the basis, they can be joined in the following sense, in the sense that there exist two other elements of the basis such that the multiplicity of Z in X, Y, 1 is non-zero, and the multiplicity of Z in Y, 2, X is non-zero. So remember that this multiplicity is the multiplicity of BK in B1, in BI, BJ, like that. Multiplicity coefficient. So two random elements of the basis can be connected in this sense. There exist two others such that we have these two non-zero multiplicity. Okay. Now you take a ring category with left dual. Then its Grothendieck ring is a transitive unital Z plus ring. Okay. Okay, so what about now? Okay. You consider a transitive unital Z plus ring of finite rank. So the basis is a finite set. You take three elements of the basis. Okay. We will define the fusion matrix. So the fusion matrix for the object B in the basis is given by this entry, the multiplicity of Z in XY, and this is the entry ZY in this matrix. So the entries are parametrized by this couple like that. So if the, yeah, it's finite rank. So if the rank is R, then this matrix is a R by R matrix. And this corresponds to the left multiplication matrix transpose. It's transpose because we transpose the N1. Okay. And the Frobenius-Perron dimension of the object X is nothing but the matrix norm of MX. Okay. Why we need to transpose? Because we want to use this matrix as a representation of the Grothendieck ring. In fact, by associativity, you can, so I will not go into the details, but using this associativity reformulate like that combinatorially, which reformulate exactly like that. So this is precisely a representation of the Grothendieck ring. And for that, we need to transpose. Otherwise, you have technical problems. Okay. So what is a fusion ring in this framework? In this framework, a fusion ring is a unital Z plus ring of finite rank together with an involution, a bijection from the base to itself, such that the fusion matrix of the dual is the matrix adjoint of the fusion matrix. The matrix adjoint is an evolution, so this is an evolution. And this encodes the Frobenius reciprocity, as I already mentioned several times. So the dual at the fusion ring level corresponds to the matrix adjoint. Okay. Okay, so. Wait a minute. Message. Okay, oh, it's okay. So theorem, the Frobenius power dimension, so the matrix norm of the fusion matrix of the object X, is in fact a positive eigenvalue of the matrix, and in fact it is the maximal one. So this is this is completely obvious because in the way I define it, it is it's the matrix norm is always more or less like that. Okay. So here maybe I made a confusion, not a confusion, but in fact, anyway, it's okay. I mix some definition. I use another equivalent definition for that. And this, but it's the only thing you have to remember is that the Frobenius power dimension is just a matrix norm of the fusion matrix of the object. And it has some property. Okay. If you define it anyway, if you define it as it is defined in the book, in fact, in the book it is not defined like that. So I mix a bit. It does not matter. Okay. So this Frobenius-Perron dimension. So the matrix norm of an integral matrix, so a matrix with integral entries, is not necessarily an integer. It's an algebraic integer, but not necessarily an integer in general. So this notion of Frobenius-Perron dimension is not necessarily an integer. Okay. So I already mentioned that. This Frobenius-Perron dimension induces a ring homomorphism on the Grothendieck ring, such that by definition, as defined, it maps the basis to the non-negative real number. In fact, non-negative algebraic algebraic integer. Okay. Okay. So that was defined. Everything was defined for finite, because we need finiteness to get the Frobenius per dimension. For finite ring category, with left dual, or for finite tensor category. Okay. So, of course, when you start from the category of representation on a finite group, what you get as a Frobenius per dimension is precisely the dimension of the representation. So it's no surprise here. Okay, so that was the end of the review of the first semester. You see? So now it's okay for Grothendieck ring and Frobenius per dimension. Let me start with some new notion. So not new. Now we can start to cover the semester two, to review the semester two. Okay, so quantum trace, pivotal and spherical category. So that's really, really important. So we define the notion of Frobenius per dimension for the tensor category. And this Frobenius per dimension, in fact, can be defined at the level of the Grothendieck ring. So it can be defined at the algebraic level. But there is another notion of dimension we will introduce here, which may be different from the Frobenius per dimension. It is called the categorical dimension. And in fact, there, when the Frobenius per dimension and the categorical dimension are the same, the category is called pseudo-unitary. Why pseudo-unitary? Because there is a notion of unitary category, and unitary implies pseudo-unitary. But it's strict. It's a strict implication. A strict... let me check. I guess it's an open problem whether every pseudo-unitary tensor category admits a unitary structure. Yeah, it's an open problem. But what is known is that there is, we know existence of tensor category without a pseudo-unitary structure. In fact, we know existence of, no, this is what we know is fusion ring and without pseudo-unitary categorification. Fusion ring with categorification, but without pseudo-unitary categorification. Otherwise, it's easy to find a tensor category without pseudo-unitary structure. What is not easy is to find fusion ring with categorification, but without pseudo-unitary categorification. That was done by Chaupierre recently. Okay. And here I mentioned that why, what about unitary? So usually in physics and in subfactor theory, we deal only with unitary tensor category. That's why unitary is important. Okay. So we want to talk about quantum trace, pivotal and spherical category. Quantum trace, so trace. So you start, you consider a rigid monoidal category. You take an object. You consider a morphism from this object to its double dual. And we will define its left trace, which can be represented like that, pictorially. So what is the left trace? It's a morphism from one to itself. So when you are in a tensor category, this and one is reduced to the scalar. So this, in a tensor category, this is a scalar. Here we are in a rigid monoidal, so it's not necessarily a scalar in general. Okay. So you start from one, you apply co-evaluation, you have that. You apply the morphism A here and the identity here, you get that. And you apply the evaluation map, you come back to one. So this is a trace, left trace of A can be represented like that. Similarly, you have the left, the right trace, so like that, of a morphism from an object to its double right dual. Okay. So as I said, these two objects are, these two morphisms are in AND of one. So in the tensor category, it's a scalar. Okay. So you take two objects in a rigid, two objects VW in a rigid monoidal category. You take two such morphisms, A from V to double star V and B from W to double star W, as above. Then this proposition states that the left trace as it is defined above is equal to the right trace of the dual of the morphism A. Okay. Moreover, if the category is additive, then the direction deal with the left trace like that. You can, the left trace of the direction is the sum of the left trace. Same thing for the tensor product. The left trace of tensor is the product of the left trace. Okay. Okay. So then, if so, here you take the morphism from V to V. So you change, in fact, you make a variation of A like that. And this is saying that, so if you put a C, you can move it on the left with double star. And same thing for the right trace. And that's also true for the right trace. Okay, so this is some technical property. Why I was a proof, this is strange. So yeah, so this this slide, I wrote this slide in the second semester, that's why I write the proof, but I will skip the proof because it's a review part. But you see basically the proof of this reduced to some picture. The picture for the dual, the zigzag relation, etc. So you see everything reduced to picture. Now we will generalize. We can generalize this to, remember the generalization of the direct product is the short exact sequence. Exact sequence. So you take a multi-tensor category, two objects, one morphism from V to V double star. Okay, so this is too technical. You take a sub-object such that the morphism map to the W map to the double dual, etc. So this is too technical, I will skip that. So you get something like that, we generalize. And in fact, the point is that you can reduce to this short exact sequence. Okay. What about the notion of pivotal structure? So a pivotal structure will be a morphism as above from X to X double star, but with some additional property. So you consider rigid monoidal category. A pivotal structure denoted A will be an isomorphism of monoidal functor between the monoidal functor identity. An isomorphism, so it's a collection of morphism as above, indexed by all the objects, such that for all morphism, in fact, for all morphism, so you compose that with a morphism here, you can move it on the left with double dual. Or here, in fact, it is this structure is monoidal in the sense that A, AX tensor Y is AX tensor AY. That can be represented pictorially like that. So this pivotal structure is equal to that, this product. This is how you denote the product of morphism. And here, you have the double dual of F, A are isomorphism, so you can put the A on the other way. So you put make the double dual, you put A and A here, inverse, X and Y, and you come back to F. Okay. So it's a way to handle the double dual. You have the double dual, you have the pivotal structure, you come back to F. Okay, so a rigid monoidal category equipped with a pivotal structure is called a pivot, it's called pivotal. And as I already said, maybe it's an open problem whether every fusion category admit a pivotal structure. It's a strongly expected the existence of such a pivotal structure in general, but it's open. Okay, so that's okay. Here is a list of technical lemma about the pivotal structure. So you take a rigid monoidal category with a pivotal structure, then, so the pivotal structure has it's a natural isomorphism of monoidal functor, an isomorphism of monoidal functor given by a collection of isomorphism. And in fact, you have this relation. The dual of X, AX is A dual of X inverse, like that. Okay. So all these lemma can be proved pictorially. In fact, you have this relation, the evaluation map dual is a co-evaluation map of the dual of the object. Idem here, co-evaluation X dual is evaluation of the dual of the object. So that can be proved pictorially like that with some zigzag relation and the picture for evaluation and co-evaluation map. Okay, so you have this technical lemma also. So here I stated the lemma directly with picture. So you have the pivotal structure, you have an evaluation map here. So you can move the pivotal structure on the other side, but you have to modify it. Here there is a dual, here there is no more dual, but there is an inverse. So you have to be careful. So it's, yeah. In fact, same thing here. In fact, you can prove that using using the previous lemma. So you apply the double dual on evaluation and co-evaluation map. You apply the pivotal structure here, and then you remember the pivotal structure is how to deal with the double dual here, remember it's written, you have the double dual. So we are considering the double dual here. Here is identity, so you have that. So pictorially, it's quite easy to prove. So it's a good exercise to do that by yourself. Okay. And finally, we can prove by applying all this, we can prove the lemma zero. So we start from that, you get that. Okay. Okay, so if you apply two times the lemma zero, you get that. You apply the lemma zero, you apply the star here, lemma zero again. Okay, so you have a list of identities. You need to know that will be very helpful in some proof. In fact, when you manipulate pivotal structure, you need to know all such identities. Okay, so again, example of pivotal category. So as usual, the usual category VEC G, REP G, they are all pivotal structure. In fact, this pivotal structure comes from the usual isomorphism of the double dual of a vector space. So you have a vector space, you have the dual space, the form, and the double dual, so the form space of the space of the form, by the double dual. So there is an isomorphism between these two things. And it is used to make a pivotal structure on this usual category. Okay. Okay, so we mentioned a notion of categorical dimension. So we are coming to that. So you fix a pivotal structure on a rigid monoidal category. The dimension of an object X with respect to A, so we will see, we may see later in what sense it can, in some cases, it can be independent of A, maybe. So you consider the left trace of the pivotal structure at index X. Okay, so this is the definition of the dimension of X with respect to A, and as we said in the tensor category, then this is the scalar only, so this is a number, but in general it's not a scalar. We need the assumption that is equal to that, so it is in the assumption of tensor category but not in the multi-tensor category, for example. So you have, wait a minute, but wait a minute. Okay, so the dimension of E with respect to A is equal to the dimension of this double dual. Okay. So this reduces to some picture and some result we proved before. Okay, so here I wrote as an exercise that the pivotal structure is additive. I guess, yeah, in a tensor category. should it be assumed or should be proved? I don't remember. Okay, so what about now? So you take a tensor category with a pivotal structure. So you, in fact, this dimension with respect to A is invariant. So it only depends on the class of in the Grothendieck ring, in fact. Okay. And this is a character, the ring homomorphism of the Grothendieck ring. So we need to prove here, we will not do because it's a review part, but we need to prove it's well defined. In fact, X is an element of the class. This is a class. Okay. So you have this dimension is a ring homomorphism of the Grothendieck ring. In fact, the Frobenius Parent dimension is also a ring homomorphism of the Grothendieck ring. In the pseudo-unitary case, they are the same, as I said. But in general, you can have, they can be different, and you can have several, you have several ring homomorphisms, several characters. Okay, so if the Grothendieck ring is commutative, the number of different characters, at least for a fusion ring, the number of a commutative fusion rings, the number of characters is exactly the rank of irreducible characters. Okay. So blah blah blah, I skip the proof. Okay, so next. So as I said, the Frobenius parent dimension is an algebraic integer because this is a matrix norm of a matrix with integral entry. This is the same for this pivotal dimension. They are also algebraic integer. Okay. Now, what about the notion of spherical category? So a spherical structure. So remember, we state that the dimension of V with respect to A is equal to the dimension of V double star with respect to A. But we did not prove it is equal for V star, to V star, only V double star. So it's not, a priori, not true in general. We have this equality. We have this equality for V double star. If we have this equality with V star only, not double star, then the pivotal structure is called spherical. Okay? And the tensor category with a spherical structure is called spherical. Okay. What about next? Okay, so here I mentioned something a bit technical. So in the literature, you can find, so here we define spherical this equality for any object. In fact, this remark states that you only need to have this equality for simple object by additivity. But in the literature, in fact, you can see an alternative equivalent definition for spherical, which is saying that for all objects and for all morphism between these objects, the trace, what we are talking about, this trace here is equal to this trace of the alpha dual. Okay. OK. So maybe I will not go into the details. Why the two definitions are equivalent? Because one way is trivial, just take alpha equals the identity. And the other way, so maybe we will mention the other way here, but I will go quickly. So this is, I already said, so I forgot to erase. That tensor structure. This is already, I already said that. So one way is trivial, as I said, and the other way is non-trivial, but I will skip because it's, yeah. The other way is written here. If you're interested, you can read the details. So I did not put picture, but you see it reduced to some picture. So you start from that. And you get what you want. So I skip that. It will make too much time for this review part. Okay. So you consider a spherical tensor category. You take an object. Okay. You take a morphism between this subject and itself. Okay. So here, so the left trace of that is the right trace when you put that on the other way with the inverse. Okay. So it looks like a technical. So why I need that? Maybe I use that as a theorem in this proof here, no? Maybe. Not sure, but let's see. Okay. No, maybe not. Okay, so what about that? So it looks like that, in fact. Okay, so for all x in spherical, anyway, it may be related to what we did before. So I will skip the proof as usual. First, the proof is you make the proof in the semi-simple case. And then you generalize to the non-semi-simple case by considering Jordan Holder filtration, etc. So I skip the proof. Okay. So now we. So we will make the pause. Okay, so we finished before the pause. We mentioned, yeah. So spherical structure. Okay, so here we need to introduce some notion about group action. We will use later. So you take a group acting on a set, a non-empty set. This action is called transitive if for all two elements of the set, there is an element of the group such that you can move from the first element to the other element, like that. Every two elements of the set is connected by an element of the group. And free mean that if for all elements of the group, if the action of two elements G and H are the same, which this mean that the H and G are the same also. So maybe that should be written to be strictly correct. That should be written here. If gh equal gx equal hx for all x, then okay. I guess. Yeah. Finally, if you have the action of a group on a set such as the action is both transitive and free, then the set is called a G torso. Okay. Sorry, I don't. Yeah. We will use that soon, I guess. Yeah, here. Okay, so you consider two, yeah, in fact, this, yeah, we will consider structure of several pivotal structures. You consider two pivotal structures on a tensor category. Okay, so this state that they are related one to the other by an element on the monoidal automorphism of this functor. Okay. This is a group of natural monoidal automorphism of the identity functor. Okay. And if you take two such element here, such that you have that, so this look like the free here. So this is transitive and this corresponds to free here. Then you have to show that, okay. So in other words, the set of isomorphism class of pivotal structure is a torsor for this group. That's why we mention, yeah. So, okay, we don't need to care that much about that. Okay, and if you replace pivotal by spherical, you can put a two here, which means that the group of element of order less than or equal to two. Anyway. What about now? We will focus on semi-simple case. Okay, so you take a field as usual, algebraically closed. So in the semi-simple case, so you take a semi-simple multi-tensor category. You take an object, then the right dual is isomorphic to the left dual. And then the double right dual is isomorphic to itself, to the V. V double dual, left double dual is isomorphic to V. okay. So this is a proof. So this statement is not true if you don't assume semi-simple in general. You have a counterexample of that here in the book, this section of the book. You have an example of non-semi-simple category for which this is not isomorphic to that. Okay. Okay. So this leads to the existence. So the open problem I mentioned before is only open when this is isomorphic to that. Otherwise, if V and V double star are not isomorphic, then there is no point to get a pivotal structure because the pivotal structure requires a collection of isomorphism like that. So open problem, is it true that for every semi-simple tensor category, there is a pivotal structure, a spherical structure? It's open even for fusion categories. In fact, I mentioned fusion category before. Okay, but it's known to be true for unitary fusion category because unitary implies pseudo-unitary, pseudo-unitary implies spherical, and spherical implies pivotal. We will see that later in the course. So you have a hierarchy of a structure, unitary, pseudo-unitary, spherical, pivotal. In fact, for physics and subfactor theory, we are mainly interested in the unitary case. So there is no problem about spherical or pivotal structure. Everything is fine. Okay. Okay, so here I mentioned a question. Is there a multi-tensor category such that we have this isomorphism for all, but no pivotal structure? Okay. So here we don't assume semi-simple, etc., etc. So it's a bit. It's a small generalization of this open problem. Okay, so you take a semi-simple tensor category. So recall that. Why are we considering semi-simple? Because recall the notion of fusion category. A fusion category is a finite semi-simple tensor category. So we are interested in semi-simple tensor category first. So you take a semi-simple tensor category, you take a simple object, V, you consider an isomorphism. So we know that both are isomorphic, my previous result. So you can pick one isomorphism, and then this proposition states that the left and right trace of alpha is non-zero. So I repeated this here. Okay, so the proof is written here. Okay, so this is very important. This is very important. So you should go through the proof if you did not attend it the second semester. Otherwise, you should watch the video of the second semester where I explain this proof in details. Okay. So again, here you have a counterexample. So this is false without the semi-simple assumption. Here you have the basic counterexample. You take a group on a positive characteristic, a representation of group in positive characteristic here, P, the same P here. Then GLP, so all the invertible matrix over of P by P matrix over this field, you take the usual representation. And this representation is of dimension P, but in characteristic P, P equals zero. So you have, remember that this dimension here, this is an element of, this is not the Frobenius power dimension. It's not a real, it's an element of the field. So here the field is characteristic P, so P equals zero. So you have something equals zero. So you don't have this property. It's not non-zero, it's zero. This is a counterexample in characteristic P, but they also exist counterexample in characteristic zero. I just state that without mentioning the example, it exists. Now, what about the Grothendieck ring in the semi-simple case? We will be able to provide additional property. It's no more just a unit Z-plus ring, but it will be a based ring. So you take a Z-plus ring as defined before with its basis. You consider this specific subset corresponding to the unit, decomposing the unit. Then you consider a specific group homomorphism which will deal with the unit. So he's saying that. So what he's saying? He's saying, so it is defined on all the ring, but linearly you can define it only on the basis. So it is one if the element of the basis in this subset corresponding to the decomposition of the unit, otherwise it's zero. Okay. So a based ring is a Z plus ring with an additional assumption involving this tool here. So you have a Z plus ring, you have this basis, and there exists an evolution, as we did for fusion ring, in fact. We have an evolution such that this involution on the set of the basis extend linearly like that. And it's an anti involution, which means that involution mean you apply two times, it's the same thing. Anti involution mean, in general, for two, if you make a product of two elements of the ring, you switch the dual of AB is B dual times A dual, like that. It's called dual involution. And it involves the tau. So you must have that the product of two elements of the basis. You apply tau, it should be one if they are dual to each other and zero otherwise. Which mean basically that this product contain a component of the unit if and only if they are dual to each other. And in fact, it contain a single component of the unit, because it's written one here. So of multiplicity one. Let me check. I have a doubt here. Maybe it's anyway. But in the unital case, there is no problem because the unit is an element of the basis. Otherwise, I should check that anyway. Okay. So here we'll mention some basic results about based ring. Okay, so the involution is stable on the subset decomposing the unit. So you take an element in the subset, the dual is also in the subset. So the unit is written like that, so it's not what we wrote before. Okay. So he's saying that the coefficient is trivial, is one. Okay. Ok. So the proof is here. So this tau of AB equal tau of B, like for a trace of a matrix, you have that. Okay, so it's a trace in that sense. And also, it's tau of A star equal tau of A. Okay. Here, we use this tau to define an inner product of two elements of the ring, the base ring, tau of B star A. So this inner product, this two form, is symmetric in that sense. Symmetric, so you can reverse A and B like that. Okay, and if you make a product of two elements of the basis, then it decomposes like that, where the coefficient is given by this inner product here. In other words, the inner product recover the fusion structure like that. And you get exactly the Frobenius reciprocity as using, as I said, you can move this here and you put a star. So this is exactly the Frobenius reciprocity, can be written like that. Okay, so here is a proof. So it's basically use exactly what we know. There is no surprise here, no trick. Okay, so. Okay, so here I proposed an exercise for which I was not sure it is true. So a based ring is the same thing as a Z plus ring together with the Frobenius reciprocity. So this. Yeah. Okay. Now, strongest proper notion: multifusion ring and fusion ring. So you came back to fusion ring, finally. So a multifusion ring is a based ring of finite rank. So the basis is finite. And a fusion ring is a unital multifusion ring. So the unit is an element of the basis. And so, as I said, I am mainly interested in this case. Okay, so you consider a multifusion ring, so a based ring of finite rank. So a Z plus ring with an evolution and this property with the tau. Then you consider, you pick one element here and you define this sum like that. And this proposition is saying that this sum is central. So this is central. So to prove that, you just need to prove this equal this for all elements of the basis. And it is proved like that involving the Frobenius reciprocity here. Okay. So we finished with this definition of based ring, fusion ring, etc. So of course, this definition of fusion ring is equivalent to the definition I provided in the introduction and later also. Okay. So, now we will state what you can expect, in fact, the correspondence between tensor category, Bayes ring, fusion category, fusion ring, etc. So you take a semi-simple multi-tensor category, then its Grothendieck ring is a Bayes ring. If it is tensor, then it is unital. If it is fusion, then it is fusion ring. And same multi, multi, etc. So the notation before is okay, what you can expect here. So, okay. So as I said, in the unital case, the unit is a simple object. So in the unital case, this corresponds to the multiplicity of one in B, like that. Okay, so again, a counterexample. If you don't assume semi-simple, I see. So in the unital case, as I said, you have only one, so you should have. So this is what I said before, that there may be a mistake here, but in the unital case, you should have equal to one. And when it is semi-simple, but you have example when it is not semi-simple, it is greater than one. So, okay. So able proposition, yeah, so it's not a Bayes ring. Not a Bayes ring. Okay. So the counterexample involves the same example as before. Find a group, a representation of a positive characteristic. So you can have one appear in multiplicity two in this tensor product. Okay. Okay, so here I mentioned the smallest counterexample. You can take P equal 2. And so the smallest counterexample is of order 6. So the only non-commutative group of order 6 is a symmetric group S3. So you have a counterexample with a group of order 6. S3 is a counterexample in the field F2, characteristic 2. Okay, so so let me check something very quickly if I'm in the book. Bayes ring, all right. 49. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Okay, so I did not make a mistake before. It was just, okay, for in the Bayes ring, even if it is not unital, the assumption involving the map tau, it's really one, because it's tau of bi bj is equal to one blah 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 zero blah blah blah. Here it's really one, it's not more than one, because here it's the two elements of the basis, so it's not no more than one. Okay. So it's okay. There is no No mistake in the slide. I just check. So, another example. An example, a very well-known example of a fusion ring involving Lie algebra representation. You take the Lie algebra SL2, a well-known Lie algebra over the complex. You consider the category of finite dimensional representation. Not finite, so it's not a fusion ring. It's a semi-simple tensor category. It has infinitely many simple objects. And every simple object can be parametrized by a number like that, such that the fusion rule are given by the Clebsch-Gordan rule like that. They are all self-dual. And the tensor product of two irreducible like that, it's a direct sum of such irreducible with this coefficient from zero to the minimum like that. So the Clebsch-Gordan rule, it is very well known. So in some sense, our first non-trivial example of non-finite semi-simple tensor category. Okay. Now we will talk about 6G symbol, F symbol. So, as I said, you have a tensor category and its Grothendieck ring, which is a unital based ring, or fusion category, its Grothendieck ring is a fusion ring. Not every fusion ring is a Grothendieck ring. A fusion ring is a Grothendieck ring if it admits its pentagon equation admits solution. And the solution of the, and here we will explain in what, how the pentagon axiom can be reformulated as an algebraic equation called the pentagon equation. And for so we will, that will involve notion of 6G symbol, F symbol. So let me explain. So you consider a semi-simple tensor category, you take the simple object, and you consider this multiplicity space. So the Ohm space between this simple object and this tensor product. It's called the multiplicity space because this tensor product of simple object is isomorphic to this decomposition, where here you have this space, multiplicity space. And so when you go to the Grothendieck ring, this is really the multiplicity space as defined before. Okay, so now you compute this tensor product in two ways according to the parentization. You get two different sum of multiplicity space. Both are isomorphic, but you get different multiplicity space. So the associativity constraint provide a collection of linear isomorphism between this direct sum of tensor product of multiplicity space. And this isomorphism is denoted like that with four parameters corresponding to this, and this. Okay. So these are matrix. You consider the GL block of this matrix. So this block map this space to this space. It is called 6G symbol. In general, it's not a scalar, it's a block. 6G because you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six parameters. Okay. This multiplicity space may be of a dimension greater than one. If it is of multiple, if the tensor category is of multiplicity one, then this space are all of dimension one, and then this block reduced to a scalar. But in general, they are of dimension greater than one. So if you want to go further, you need to fix a basis on this space, of this space. You fix a basis, and then you can get every entry of this block according to the chosen basis. So you need to you fix a basis, and you then you fix element in the basis, and then you can finally get a scalar. This scalar is called the F symbol. Okay, so I will not go into the details here. It's just to fact that we wrote a paper about that. This is called tetrahedron. In some good case, the F symbol can be depicted as a as a label tetrahedron. So all this. All the chosen element of the basis, all the chosen morphism here, go to the corner, given corner, one corner of each edge, and every element here, which correspond to simple object, label the vertices. Edge correspond to this is edge, this is vertices, okay. So every simple object corresponds to one, to you label the edge with simple object, and you label the vertices with a morphism here in the basis. And in fact, more than that, you fix a corner, which is important. Okay, but you don't need to care that much about that. We will not come back to that. This is not in, in the book. This is just my a way to depict this F symbol. It's important to have that in mind. In fact, we wrote a paper about that, but this is not in the book. Okay, so as I said, in the multiplicity free case, which means multiplicity one, which means that the multiplicity space are of dimension at most one, then there is nothing to choose here, so the F symbol reduced to the 6G symbol. For example, the example we mentioned before, you see here there is no multiplicity. So it's a direct sum of objects, which is zero or one. So multiplicity. So the previous example we mentioned, the 6G symbol are the equal to the F symbol. Okay, and so now how to get the algebraic equation from the Pentagon axiom. So the Pentagon axiom so induce a system of polynomial equation of degree three called the Pentagon equation, where the variable are the F symbol and the equation are of this form. So of degree three on the right, of degree two on the left. So pictorially, so this is really, as I said, this is overdeterminated. It's a huge, in general, huge system. And as an exercise, you can fill the blank here. Yeah. Pictorially, you have that, where every tetrahedron are labeled as above. And in fact, as as we did in this paper, this can be seen as two ways to evaluate into details. It's not the point of this course, but it's good to have that in mind. This triangular prism can be evaluated in two ways. So intuitively like that, one way, so it's here, one way, and the other way Here you have tetrahedron, so you have F symbol. Okay. So remember that the F symbol correspond to come from the associativity constraint. And so this equation is a reformulation of the Pentagon equation. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 Pentagon equation. The Pentagon axiom can be reformulated into an equation of M symbol like that, which can be seen as two ways to evaluate the triangular prism here. In some good case, we explain in this paper. Okay, so now we arrive at the chapter about Hopf algebra. It remains 5-7 minutes. Okay, so the main family of non-trivial, non-usual example of a tensor category come from Hopf algebra. But in fact, we will see that Hopf algebra theory and tensor category theory is closely related. In fact, the Hopf algebra theory came first, but now the tensor category has a lot of application in Hopf algebra theory. And in fact, today, many people in Hopf algebra theory are doing tensor category. Personally, I don't come from Hopf algebra theory. I come from subfactor theory and von Neumann algebra, which is another way. There is another correspondence between subfactor theory and tensor category. In fact, as we will explain a bit later, a subfactor is the same thing as a unitary tensor category together with a Frobenius algebra, a unitary Frobenius algebra. So the subfactor theory is also another way to provide lot of new examples of tensor category. And in fact, lot of new examples of non-integral tensor category, because as we will explain here, Hopf algebra provide only integral example. Okay. So, So the idea here is to go from tensor category to Hopf algebra. So we will start from tensor category, and then we will recover the Hopf algebra theory. But for going from that to that, you need the notion of fiber functor. Notion of fiber functor. So you take a ring category. And we will define what is a fiber functor. First, we will define what is a quasi-fiber functor. So a quasi-fiber functor on the ring category is an exact faithful K-linear functor from C to VEC. Remember, we already mentioned this before. Yesterday, if I don't remember. So this is a fiber quasi-fiber functor. So remember, exact mean it keeps the short exact sequence. Faithful mean injective on the Ohm set. K-linear we already remember, and vect is the trivial category of vector space. So you have such a functor to vec. So okay, such that. The unit map to the trivial object here, the one-dimensional vector space, and it is equipped with a natural isomorphism J, like that, so the monoidal structure here. So here you have just a natural isomorphism like that. And if it is a monoidal structure, it's a fiber functor. This is what the point as I wanted to say before. So equipped with a natural isomorphism like that. Okay. And if moreover, this is a monoidal structure, so which means that we already defined a monoid. I don't remember why I did not write monoidal structure. Anyway, so if this, you have the commuting diagram here, removing the ambiguity related to the associativity constraint, then it is called a fiber functor. So this is, as I said, you have this natural isomorphism, which is not necessarily a monoidal structure. And this is the notion of monoidal structure here. Okay. So quasi-fiber functor, fiber functor. What we want is fiber functor. Okay. Yeah, so this is what I said, in other words. The fiber functor is a tensor functor from C to VEC. So tensor functor, you have the monoidal structure. And a quasi-fiber functor is a quasi-tensor functor. So quasi-tensor functor is just that without the monoidal structure. So sorry to, I'm just repeating three times the same thing. Okay, and here there are examples of example of fiber functor when you have VEC and the usual representation, you have a fiber functor, but when you deform with a three cocycle here, you only have a quasi fiber functor. Okay. And I go quick because it's almost the end. Here is the forgetful functor. The forgetful functor, so you forget the structure, the G-grady structure of the group representation structure. The forgetful functor is a fiber functor in this case, but in this case with a non-trivial three cocycle, it's just a quasi-fiber functor. Okay. And here I will not go into the details, but this explains why we are talking about fiber functor, because this looks like to something in topology, fiber functor, a fiber, it's topological fiber. So if you are interested in the history talking about fiber functor, you can read this part. I try to make it with some color to explain. You involve representation of the group, the fundamental group of a connected topological space, etc., etc. So I guess we can stop here. So I will stop here.